Party, trying desperately to revive her skating career.
Tonya Harding was the greatest female athlete in figure skating the United States ever had in terms of pure raw talent. She was a fullback in a pair of skates. There was no one who had the physical talent, the jumping ability that Tonya Harding had. Absolutely no one.
She exploded on the scene in 1991 at the U.S. Nationals landing a triple axel. Still the only American woman to land the jump in a competition.
From that point on, I don't really remember doing the program.
I love it.
I just remember going through it. Just mm-hmm. Everything just came naturally, and it was so much fun.
Figure skating was excited for Tonya Harding.
And she had taken the sport, the U.S. side of women's figure skating, to a new athletic level.
U.S. gold in 91 should have paved the way for glory in Albertville at the 92 Games. She had only one obstacle, herself.
Why didn't you fulfill the dream of being a medal winner, if not gold then?
Guess I got lazy, and it's my own fault that I didn't do any better.
Tonya didn't train. She never has trained.
As the last skater to arrive in Albertville, the result was a lackluster performance. Her coach said that she was jet-lagged. Harding was edged out for the bronze by Nancy Kerrigan, while Christy Yamaguchi won the gold.
One of the great shames in the Tonya Harding story is that had she committed herself as an athlete for a four-month period between September 1991 and February 1992, none of this other nonsense might have been necessary.
Her world on and off the ice started to spiral downward in 93. Her marriage with Jeff Galluli was, at best, stormy and ended in divorce in August of that year. Then two curious events occurred. First, she returned to her ex-husband.
He came and knocked on my door one evening and said, I need some help. I'm in trouble. My skating's not going well.
Then, on the eve of an important Olympic test event in Norway, she withdrew, citing a serious medical condition.
That's the story about the ovarian cyst. I made that story up for her.
Meanwhile, a series of calamities on and off the ice took place, from loose skate blades to a suspicious death threat, and most surprisingly, a reunion with her former husband.
Well, we had gone through complete divorce, and then I was told by someone very high up that I needed to be with him, so I had to make a decision whether or not...
Somebody very high up in...
the skating world.
That you needed to still be with your husband.
Yes, ex-husband.
Ex-husband, for appearance's sake?
Because they said I had a stable life with him.
Yeah, and a lot of it was a business arrangement. She felt that the Figure Skating Association liked to see her being in a couple with me.
Oh, they knew that I was split and told me that if I was not with him, I probably would not get the marks that I would deserve. I went to competition. I ended up third at a competition, and I should have won.
The United States Figure Skating Association was contacted by Fox Sports for a comment, but declined our interview offer. Still, Harding insists she felt pressure from both ends.
Nobody knew our life. I mean, I had bruises all the time on me, and...
From?
From him. I got beat up all the time by him.
It was horrible. It was an abusive relationship. Was I physically abusive? No. And I say that without hesitation.
Most of America would still ask, was your dream that important that you would put up with physical abuse, being frightened under the same roof with your ex-husband?
All my life, that's all I ever did was skating. You know, and I missed it in 92. And I got that opportunity at the palm of my hand just to be able to go again, have a second chance to go there and get my dream. What was 3 months going to hurt me? Well, now I know. It cost me my whole entire career, my life.
Still ahead, Tonya Harding and Nancy Kerrigan face to face, reflecting on this incredible saga.
And I wasn't going to be remembered as Jeff Galluli, the fellow that tried to fix the Olympics.
From Vail, Colorado, Fox Sports welcomes you to Breaking the Ice, a look back at the 94 Winter Games and seven women drawn together by the events of history. Tonya Harding, figure skating's outsider. Just imagine, this woman who was only a heartbeat away from an Olympic medal back in 1992 is now a world apart from her peers. Acceptance back into the sport? Not likely. And at a time when figure skaters are performing for huge television audiences and packing arenas all over the world, Harding skates only for herself. Alone.
Pretty amazing when you think about it. This is the first time we've seen her skate in 4 years.
That triple toe had all the speed and all the power of the Tonya Harding we knew as an amateur. When I'm watching her skate right now, the emotions, I have very mixed emotions. I'm not feeling sympathy. I'm not feeling compassion. I don't have a desire to see this girl succeed. But what I am seeing is a package of raw talent and a fight. This girl has fought for everything since she was a little girl. For the last 4 years, everything she's been through, she could have hidden. She could have disappeared. And you know what she did? She skated. She skated because that's all she's known how to do.
And she still got the jump.
Huge double axle. She could actually still do a triple. You can say a lot of things about Tonya, good or bad, but you can't say that she can't skate, and you can't say she doesn't have guts.
Guts indeed, Roz, but the question everyone wants an answer to is, are guts enough to prevail over her incredibly troubled past?
And we have more now on a breaking story. Figure skating champion Nancy Kerrigan was attacked.
Within about 20 minutes, we reporters in the press room kind of laughed out loud and jokingly said, where was Tonya Harding during this?
So there was always this feeling that when Tonya was around, anything could happen.
I had a hard time believing it because Tonya had skated so well immediately after. I can't imagine knowing about something so horrible and actually seeing it carried out and then going out and skating well.
Without Kerrigan there, Harding dominated the competition en route to her second national championship while securing an Olympic berth.
She absolutely believed that with Nancy Kerrigan not there, that the other girls didn't pose a threat to her ability and that she would not have a problem.
Did you want your dream badly enough that you would live with your ex-husband, that you would agree and conspire with him to remove who was the biggest obstacle to
your
realizing
your dream? She was not an obstacle. That's what people don't understand. I'm really happy, but it won't be a true crown until I get my chance with Nancy, and that'll be Olympics, and let me tell you, I'm going to whip her butt.
There were two spots for the 1994 Olympic team for the women. Nancy Kerrigan was the odds-on favorite for one. Tonya Harding was the odds-on favorite for the other one. This was a no-brainer. There were two women who were going to make the team, and it was an open and shut case. So where Jeff Galluli and the boys in Portland got the idea that they had to attack someone's knee to make the Olympic team, I have no idea.
We felt we had such an investment involved here. We needed to carry it through.
From the time she landed back home in Portland, fingers were pointing to the Harding camp, especially her bodyguard, Sean Eckhart.
Well, the whole thing started to unravel because Eckhart just couldn't keep his mouth shut. And he knew so much that wasn't out there, I just don't think he could restrain himself from telling people. Yeah, ultimately, he told enough people that, the FBI got on to him. And, of course, once he was confronted by the FBI, he just collapsed and started to cooperate.
Jeff, is Tanya innocent? Anything to say to your fans?
Please believe in me.
Was there a lack of physical evidence, hard evidence that could tie her to being involved in the planning on the front end of this conspiracy?
No, there was physical evidence. The envelope that was taken from the dumpster in the Dockside Tavern, much of the handwriting on which was tied.
Dockside Tavern where?
The Dockside Tavern here in Portland. The handwriting, much of the handwriting on that envelope was identified as her, and it linked her to the phone call to the arena outside Boston and to the checking that was done there on the practice times.
Who called the arena?
Tanya did.
Why did you call the arena?
To find out if Nancy Kerrigan skated at these times. That was for Sean's information to pass on to whoever was going to make these threats against Nancy Kerrigan.
Tanya admits to pursuing Nancy, but for other reasons.
We had pictures taken from when we were on the podiums at 1991 Nationals that we did want to have signed for that, but that was it, plain and simple.
You didn't make the phone call to Massachusetts to find out about Nancy's practice time?
When I saw Nancy at Nationals, I asked her if I could send her the photo and if she would sign it and send it back to me.
FBI testimony tells a different story. Journalist Vera Morano testified to the FBI that calls from Harding to her were inquiries about Kerrigan's practice arena and home addresses.
So you maintain that you didn't know until 3 days after the attack?
No, 3 days after I got home from Nationals.
She gave the go-sign. She wasn't in any way in charge of orchestrating any of the events that happened after that, but she was involved fully from the get-go. Sean orchestrated everything.
I could never hurt anybody, ever. I mean, I got the kicked out of me all the time.
If that's the way you felt about your ex-husband, if that's the way he treated you, being abusive, physically, then why lie to the FBI to protect him and the conspirators, that which you acknowledged to the FBI? Why protect him? Why lie?
Because I asked for protection and they wouldn't give it to me.
The FBI wouldn't give you protection?
No, they wouldn't.
What did you ask for?
I asked them to put me someplace where nobody could get to me.
If you were to cooperate?
Yes.
You asked that officially of them?
Yes.
And they said?
No.
I think that's her imagination. I mean, in fact, my memory is that it's undisputed that she met alone with Galluli after that interview, and voluntarily so. So I guess I would wonder why, if she was so concerned about him, she would have done that. I mean, that's not a credible statement.
I guess what I'm saying is people are having a difficult time wondering, can Jeff really be lying? Could he have been lying to the FBI to have had so much detail about the planning of the attack?
It's very easy. I mean, he took a lie detector test when he first got his attorney and totally failed it.
I took two polygraph tests. I took one with my attorney to try and substantiate our claim that we weren't involved and failed it miserably. Polygraph test with the FBI, I passed, admitting my involvement and Donnie's involvement.
I took one, and I passed.
I mean, if she passed the polygraph exam, then where's the report that she passed the exam? The report has never been released by her or any of her representatives, I suspect, because it would show otherwise.
It's almost like the Three Stooges. I mean, that's really what I was involved with. I mean, and I was one of them. I mean, if there was five of us, it'd be the Five Stooges. I mean, absolutely ridiculous.
What is your plea to the charge of racketeering?
Guilty.
Galluli served 8 months of a 2-year sentence. But since then, he's changed his name, remarried, and desperately seeking to clear his conscience.
Obviously, the way I was thinking, the way I was living, the way my beliefs were
led me exactly to where I was, which was prison, and a very unhappy life. Since then, I decided I needed a new lease on life, thus the name changed. And I wasn't going to be remembered as Jeff Gillooly, the fellow that tried to fix the Olympics. I did not want to be remembered for that.
People say, aren't you angry that you went to prison and that Tanya got what they say, you know, see as a slap on the wrist? And I say, no. I went to prison, I did what I did, but I'm, you know, my soul is clean. She has chosen to, and it looks like she will for the rest of her life, taken the stand that of limited involvement in this whole thing. She's got to live with that guilty conscience until she decides to come clean, and that is a sentence that was much harsher than anything that was handed down to me.
When we return, the event they said could never happen. Tanya Harding, Nancy Kerrigan, face-to-face, only on Fox.
Hey, so the anticipation, the tension on the day they finally came face-to-face in the Fox studios in New York City was unique, almost suffocating. While Tanya Harding gathered herself for the confrontation, we began with Nancy Kerrigan.
How long have you two known each other prior to the Olympics, and what was the nature of the relationship?
Probably since, I can't remember exactly, but at least since 97.
Mm-hmm.
87, I went to my first international, and we were roommates. And we've been on many world teams, and we actually made history with the 91 world, where Christy, myself, and Tanya were all, it was the first time American women had swept world championships, so it's very exciting. I mean,
so you guys are riding the crest of a nice high then.
Yeah, it was great.
In your mind, was it the last thing that you would have suspected that it was one of your colleagues who was involved with the effort to keep you out of the Olympics? Was that the last thought in your mind?
Well, it had been brought up by other people thinking that. I don't know why anyone would have thought it. Such a bizarre incident.
So as a result of other people bringing it up, did you then suspect that it might have been broken up?
No, I didn't suspect that because I think that's crazy. Why would you even say that? That's not nice. You know, that's... But... You know, it's just, I guess, a lot of pressure put on people, and they deal with it differently.
You know, when a lot of the sordid, bad, gory details did start to come to light, and whether it was or was not proven that she was either active or a passive participant in this, but did acknowledge guilt in terms of obstruction of justice, were you surprised that she got no jail time at all?
Absolutely. Because I read transcripts from the FBI, the investigation, and they're public knowledge, so I was allowed to read it. And in fact, in a way, they were humorous.
Mm-hmm.
And I sat there reading to my mom. And
humorous?
Because it was just... I mean, sort of dumb. there's really no nice way to say that, actually. But to sit in front of a building and move your car every 15 minutes over, you know, two spots so you don't look suspicious or something like that, or go to a city and don't bring any money or credit cards and you're going to attack someone, you know, and just really not well thought out kind of plans. And it sounded very dumb.
And all the time that has passed since, how do you regard her now?
I don't. I think probably only think about any of it when asked, or many times people will come up, or young kids that remember
And they were very young men, and they said, and they asked me about my knee and how I am, and will mention what they think of her. And I don't, but sort of, it's in the past. So much has gone by since then. I'm married, I have a baby, my own family, something I've always wanted and I just love. It's so long ago. I don't know, I just...
Has there ever been a thought prior to today of sitting down with her to try and resolve it, to reconcile, to air out the differences?
No, not by me. By many people there have been. But I have a lot going in my life that I care about. I never had anything against her personally, so I just don't understand the whole thing, how it all happened, but then afterwards, I guess, just gets a little tense.
Mm-hmm. Understand. Is there any room in your heart for forgiveness?
Well, I think for Mo that I just hope that she can learn from that and better her life and not hurt anybody else.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
December 22nd.
This is the first time that you two have sat face to face since.
Mm-hmm.
Nancy, without a doubt, you two have been, are, and will forever be linked to Lillehammer and the incident. How has that impacted your life and skating events?
Well, I think for skating, the incident in a bizarre way has helped the sport because it brought awareness to the sport so many millions of people watched that otherwise would never have. And I think because of that, they watched and enjoyed it, and they're still fans now of the sport. And they watched because of the so-called rivalry, which I don't think there is any rivalry and never was.
And the impact on your life specifically?
Well, I was hurt for obviously no reason. Luckily still got to get well enough in time to go and compete and skate the performances of my life with the help of my family and the world, really. The entire world got behind me. It was just phenomenal how many people were there supporting me, and I couldn't have gotten through all of it without all of them.
A silver lining through adversity. What about you, Tanya? How has it impacted your life and skating from your perspective?
Well, it was really hard because my whole life I always built everything around my skating career, and I lost everything. I mean, I lost my life and my career and everything else, and it's been really, really hard. But first of all, I'd like to say that congratulations on your marriage and everything else and your new baby. You look great. It's just been really, really difficult. But I go on, and I'm sure it's just Nancy. She just wants the whole thing to just go away. You know, she started a new life, and, you know, just let everything just go away.
Has it gone away?
No, not at all. Not at all.
How much do you think about it? How often do you think about it?
I think about it every day. I mean, I come across people that come up every single day and say something to me. And so it's always really hard to deal with it.
Have you grown apathetic with respect to those responses? Do you understand why people continue to ask? How do you deal with it? Is it painful?
It's very painful. I mean, Nancy, I want to apologize again for being in the wrong place at the wrong time, around the wrong people. If I would have known anything, you know, in the beginning, I would have done anything I could to stop it. Anything. I mean, I would have dropped everything I had in my whole life to do that. I mean, I say that from the bottom of my heart. I really do. I really do.
But clearly there's still a large segment of the population that thinks that you were either passively or actively involved in the planning and execution of it. True or false? Absolutely false.
Absolutely false.
Why do you think then if that is the case, why did you become, at least as I understand it, a main focus of the investigation?
I don't know.
Were you aware that the plot also, at least in discussion, included the possibility of murdering Nancy Kerrigan?
Excuse me?
Did you know that the plot and those who were involved, the conspirators, if you will, had discussed possibly murdering Nancy Kerrigan?
No. Oh, my God. No, I did not know that. I did not know that.
Or cutting her Achilles tendon. None of that you knew about.
No.
Is this in any way closure for you, although you've indicated you put it behind you? Is this in any way closure? Forgiveness?
It will always be there. I mean, I'm just saying it was right linked with an Olympics. And it'll probably be brought up many times. So something that will always be brought back. And there was a lot of pain there for me and my family. And I think it was just unnecessary. Something that just shouldn't have happened in the first place.
Is this closer for you at all, face to face with Nancy?
Well, I would hope that we could go on and just live our separate lives. And I just ask forgiveness that, you know, she has her life and I have my life. And I would hope that we could just, you know, end it.
Is there anything else that you'd like to say to Nancy before parting? Anything that you've had in your mind these past 4 years that you like to say to her?
I would just like to say that, you know, I've always wished you the best. I mean, we were friends. I mean, we were on tour together. We always competed together. And, you know, from the bottom of my heart, I really think that you're a wonderful person, and I always have. I always admired you and your skating and your family, and I loved your mom and dad. I mean, I thought that they were always so supportive. And it was hard because I wish that I would have been able to have something like that. And now with my godparents, I have that. And I thank the Lord for that. And so it's just, I just want to have a new beginning to be able to start a life and be able to live happy.
Your response?
I'm glad you've moved on and hope that never anything happens like this again and you find happiness. And I hope children can learn from such mistakes and not have any kind of recurrence.
Thank you, Nancy.
Thank you.
Well, let you go, yeah. Okay.
Right.
Oh, well, we've got a couple more questions for you then, fine. Okay.
And with that, an incredibly emotional day for Nancy Kerrigan had come to a close. She had faced Tonya Harding.
As you read her body language, knowing her as long as you have, how did you read it? How did you interpret what you were saying to her, what you asked of her?
It was very hard for her to be here. And I just thank her for giving me the opportunity to sit here and in front of her face to face to say that I'm sorry.
You were pretty courageous to be sitting here as well. What were you hoping for, and did you accomplish it in your mind?
I don't know if I accomplished it or not. I just came because I wanted to say that I was sorry.
Have you resigned yourself to the eventuality, maybe, in the minds of many, Tanya, that there are those who won't ever believe you no matter what you say, and especially in light of having acknowledged that you were guilty of an obstruction of justice?
Yeah. But there's no excuse for me not going and telling them when I found out, except that I was so afraid. I wanted some protection. And the day that I told the FBI everything that I knew, they said, okay, we have protection for you. I went to my father's place, and Jeff broke in front of their agent and beat me up. How am I supposed to feel? How am I supposed to feel if they can't even protect me?
The people who were involved in your life, any of them involved in any way, shape, form, or fashion in your life now?
No. No one.
Any threats since then by your ex-husband or anyone associated with him since then?
Yes.
Recently?
In the last few months.
Specifically?
I've had phone calls on my phone.
Threatening you?
Yes.
How so?
Calling me bad names, telling me to watch out, and hanging up.
A nightmare that won't die.
I don't think so.
If you could ever hope for closure on this from your perspective, Tanya, what would it be? How would it end up?
That I can just live peacefully, happy, and have forgiveness for Nancy and her family.
My final question then, Tanya, when all is said and done, and you're at life's end, can you leave this earth comfortable in the knowledge that you have no hand, actively or passively, in the attack, and that what you're asking for, not only in the way of forgiveness from her, but maybe from others as well, is genuine and should be given?
I believe so, because the Lord knows where my heart is, and the Lord is the only one who knows the whole truth.
And your heart is where, and the truth is?
The truth is that I believe that I will go to heaven because he believes in me.
Because you had nothing to do with it.
I had nothing to do with it.
Thank you very much, Tanya.
Continues to blame the lack of security on the FBI. Federal and local authorities, as shown earlier on Fox, dispute this allegation. Was there closure? Well, judging by this face-to-face meeting, the first and quite possibly the last time such a meeting will take place, I would venture to say no. And as much as Tanya would love to be forgiven by Nancy, as much as Nancy would love to be completely disassociated from Tanya, they seem destined to forever